subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Bharat Ratna has been in the news lately. Home Minister Amit Shah, during his recent visit to Hyderabad, was asked if Bharat Ratna will be awarded to former Prime Minister P.V. Narasimha Rao, and Telugu NRI groups have also been mobilizing support across the world to request the Modi government to confer Bharat Ratna on Rao. But did you know that the Supreme Court was once called upon to decide whether these awards were constitutional? Now, at the root of this case lies Article 18 of the Constitution. One of the lesser spoken about articles in the Fundamental Rights chapter of the Constitution, the provision actually bars the government from conferring any title on anybody and prohibits citizens from accepting any title from any foreign state as well. This was basically added to the Constitution to put an end to the British practice of conferring various titles on Indian citizens who curried favor with the Britishers. Now, awards like Bharat Ratna were first challenged before the Kerala High Court and the Madhya Pradesh High Court, while the Madhya Pradesh High Court even temporarily restrained the government from conferring any national award. The Supreme Court transferred both the cases to itself in March 1994. Now, in a judgment delivered in December 1995, the Supreme Court then ruled that these awards, these national awards actually, do not amount to titles, but allow the government to recognize excellence in performance of fundamental duties by the citizens. But the court made it clear that since these awards do not amount to titles, they shouldn't be used as prefixes or suffixes to the name of recipients. That is, if a person is awarded a Bharat Ratna, he can't use Bharat Ratna in front of his name or after his name. The court in fact said that if somebody does this, they should be asked to forfeit the award, that is, return it. The court was also concerned about preserving the prestige and dignity of these awards. So it said that in any given year, they should not exceed 50 in total. Additionally, it suggested that a high-level committee can be appointed by the Prime Minister to fix the criteria for giving out such awards. From the 2G scam to the recent Calcutta High Court order for an audit of the cyclone Amphan relief distribution, the Comptroller and Auditor General of India is often spoken about when it comes to allegations of irregularities or corruption in utilization of public funds. So my next KYC episode is an explainer on what the CAG does. Now, the CAG is basically an independent authority under the Constitution. This office actually began functioning way back in 1858, and the first Auditor General was appointed in 1860. In the Constitution, Article 148 empowers the President to appoint anybody as the CAG. The current CAG is former Governor of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir, G.C. Murmu. As to what the CAG actually does, in the simplest of terms, a CAG is often called the guardian of the purse, and he is supposed to make sure that not a penny of it is spent without the authority of the parliament. In fact, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar had said that the CAG is probably the most important officer in the Constitution of India. He had explained that the CAG is the one man who is going to see that the expenses voted by the parliament are not exceeded or varied from what has been laid down by the parliament. And the extent of the CAG's powers and duties are listed under the Comptroller and Auditor General Duties, Powers and Conditions of Service Act 1971. The bottom line is that its main role is to audit the income and expenditure of the government, government bodies and state-run corporations. It has the power to examine the propriety, legality and validity of all the expenses incurred by the government, and it exercises effective control over the government accounts and expenditure incurred on schemes after they are implemented. And that is why, apart from usual audits, CAG audits also come into picture when allegations of irregularities in expenditure crop up. So, for example, it was the CAG reports that brought the spotlight on the 2G and coal scam after the CAG claimed that the allotments had caused notional losses to the tune of rupees 1.7 lakh crore and rupees 1.84 lakh crore respectively. But its methods for calculating those notional losses has been criticized in the past for being inaccurate. In 2014, the Supreme Court also upheld the right of the CAG to audit the books of private telecom companies as well. Now, a fresh petition has been filed in the Supreme Court challenging the laws that allow Muslim men to have more than one wife. while denying the same for people from other religions. So in my next KYC episode, I'll tell you more about the grounds on which the practice has been challenged and the past attempts at challenging polygamy for Muslim men. Now let's begin with what the law says first. Section 494 of the Indian Penal Code bans bigamy, that is a person marrying for a second time when the first spouse is still alive. But Section 2 of the Muslim Personal Law Shariat Application Act 1937 allows the personal laws of Muslims to prevail. But the flurry of PIs challenging polygamy for Muslim men began after the Supreme Court's 2017 judgment, which declared the practice of triple talaq as discriminatory and thereby unconstitutional. In its judgment, the court had expressly said that while it was limiting itself to the issue of triple talaq, related questions pertaining to polygamy and nikah halala would have to be addressed at a later stage. So it is within this context that Muslim women filed PILs challenging the constitutionality of polygamy, nikah, halala and other similar practices validated under Section 2 of the Shariat Act. In these petitions, as well as the most recent petition, the petitioners have essentially contended that allowing Muslim men to have more than one wife violates Article 14 and 15(1) of the Constitution. Now, Article 14 talks about equality before law and equal protection of laws. So basically, they have contended that the fact that polygamy is allowed for one religious community while it is prohibited or banned for people from other religions is actually discriminatory. Now, Article 15(1) of the Constitution bars the government from discriminating against any citizen on grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth. Now, a similar question actually came up years ago in the Bombay High Court in the Narasu Appamali case. The main question in this case was about the validity of the Bombay Prevention of Bigamous Hindu Marriages Act 1946. The petitioners had contended that the act violated Articles 14 and 15 of the Constitution, that is much similar to the contentions being made now, by discriminating between a Hindu male and a Muslim male when it comes to polygamy. But before the court could take up these core issues, it looked into whether personal laws, such as the law in question, was actually subject to fundamental rights at all. Because the Constitution says that any laws that violate fundamental rights would be invalid. But the Bombay High Court ended up ruling that personal laws are not subject to fundamental rights and so would not be void even if they are in conflict with the fundamental rights. Relying on this judgment, the Supreme Court again in 1997 rejected a challenge to the validity of the Muslim personal law which allows polygamy. The court had then opined that these were primarily questions of policy that the court should not get into. Though controversial, the Narasu Appamali judgment has not been expressly overruled yet and still holds ground. This is Apoorva Mandhani for The Print. Do subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Twitter, Instagram and Facebook.